You say a big praise the Lord tonight.
Praise the Lord.
Oh, I sense His presence in this house. We're having church in the house. Amen. Would you just turn to about five people around you and look at them and say, you're definitely in the right place on this Monday night.
As a 12-year-old girl, I was in a revival one night, and just felt like it was at the end of the service, and I thought I was saved, and but yet and still they wouldn't close the altar service, and I felt like the, you know, how you get to feel like you're the ones that's supposed to be up there, and I'm thinking, I'm saved? I mean, and I've been raised in Pentecost all my life, so it was no surprise to me, but at the same time, I hadn't given too much thought at that age of receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And so I just couldn't stay there and pinch that pew any tighter, and went down and received that precious gift that night. And so many times I have looked back through my life and thought, if I had not had the overcoming power of the Holy Ghost within me, how life could have been different. Amen. And that's just a little extra sermon there. Didn't have anything to do with what I'm fixing to sing. And actually what we're fixing to sing, it's not going to be a brand new song to anybody in here tonight. I shared last night over at University Parkway, and not shared it even with my family. But over the past, and I wouldn't say anything like this if it wasn't the truth and the Lord, I wouldn't say it for anything in this world. Most everybody in here has heard the song, There's a Miracle in the Making. A song that the Lord dropped into my spirit over 20 years ago. And we've been seeing it that long. And I've had so many testimonies to come from that. I never had a clue. And how God has taken and encouraged people so many times it was even me. But over the past few, maybe even a couple of months or so, that we've been singing this song, there's been a refreshing. And I say this tonight because sometimes when we have heard a song a humpteen dozen times, sometimes we just like, oh, well, that one. But I share this with you tonight because I believe there's some reason for it. I believe there's a refreshing in the lyrics to this song. I believe there are a lot of God's people that are sitting in congregations that need to remember, to be reminded that God is still a God of miracles. Yeah. Don't you know God's miracles? You just know what I'm talking about. He's still a God of miracles. He can still do the impossible. And that's why I still sing it after 20 years. Sometimes I know that in any size congregation, there's somebody that needs a miracle. Sometimes it's me. We're all tried. We're all tested in different ways. But I'm telling you one thing. In this day and hour we live in, we better know the God in whom we put our trust in. Amen. We better know it. And I just share that with you tonight simply because I really honestly believe what we have been feeling, the way I have sensed the Spirit of the Lord moving as we have been singing There's a Miracle in the Making over the past few weeks, that God is wanting to do something among His people. So I'm just encouraging you tonight. You know, if you're here tonight and you're the one that's needing that, because it's probably seven. If you're needing that, if you're in that impossible situation as far as you're concerned in your life, I want you to listen to the words of this song like you're hearing it for the very first time. And I want the Holy Ghost to touch your heart and you just reach out and receive that miracle tonight. Amen.
Was great.
just reach over and take somebody by the hand right now and say, I believe tonight. I stand in agreement with you tonight that there is a miracle. There is a miracle. Say it again, there is a miracle in the making. Say it one more time, there is a miracle in the making. Say it again, there is a miracle in the making. Thank you, Jesus. Thank God the days of miracles are over with. Our God is still a God of miracles. With man it's impossible, but with God all things are possible. Glory, glory. Oh, just close your eyes and just sing it one more time, would you? Just let it ring one more time. There is a miracle. Let it ring. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, let it ring. Thank you, Jesus.
One just for you, the Father.
So we put him to doing both, help him with equipment and sing. Come over here a minute, Brother Kevin. Now, I tell people about everywhere we go, how many of you see these flashy shoes he's got on? Do you see this thing? Kevin gets out there sometimes with his dress, but he loves God with all of his heart. He is a teenager, and he is a praying teenager. We do, amen. Thank God for praying teenagers. I know your pastor used to do a lot of revivals and still does some revivals up in the Virginia area. And sometimes we go up in Virginia, West Virginia, so many times a year. A few months back, we were over in West Virginia on a Saturday night. And Sunday morning, we were to be in Virginia about 70 miles or so from where we were at the night before, and I told the pastor, I said, now it's going to probably be around 2:30 when we get in. We just set up early Sunday morning. He said, that's fine. Brother Shepherd, if you need me, I don't care what time of night it is, you call me. I said, all right. Well, I always ask the pastors, whoever books us, whether it's a service, a revival, or a concert, and we can get our 45-foot bus in, because there's some places in West Virginia, Virginia, you cannot get a 45-foot bus in because we have a drug before. Actually, we've had to park our bus and had to truck our equipment down to the place that we were ministering. So after that, I always call and make sure we can get our bus in. The pastor told me, he said, Brother Shepherd, our church is up on a hill. Well, the name was a hill. To me, it's a mountain. And he said, there's one little nasty turn over into our church at the top of this hill. He said, the school buses make the turns all the time, so you shouldn't have any problem. I said, it will be. Well, after the Saturday night service, I went on to bed. Jonathan was driving. Kevin was sitting up in the front with him, and they were just talking, going down the interstate, and got off the ramp there to go to where we're supposed to be. And at the foot of the mountain, he starts up. Real foggy now, around 2, 2:15 in the morning, real foggy. He gets all the way to the top to where he's supposed to turn the right to go over to the church, and he discovers he cannot make the turn without breath. There's no way. So he parks the bus, puts his flashers on, and sends Kevin back there to get me out of the bed. He comes back there and he says, your daddy needs you quickly. So I quickly get up and go to the front. I said, what is it, son? He said, Daddy, we cannot make this turn. 2:15 in the morning, fog everywhere on top of a mountain with the flashers on in the middle of the road, and we can't make a turn. So I get my cell phone, I call the pastor. He comes down in his truck, pulls his flashlights out. We have all of our flashlights looking, and I said, Brother, we just can't make this. There's no way. We got a level system up. We've aired up as high as we can get, but there's just no way in all this bus will do. We've been here too many times and done that. Can't do it. He said, well, what can we do to solve the problem? I said, one thing. We've got to back all the way down this mountain. Well, he gets his truck, he puts his flashers on, he goes down to the foot of the mountain. Jonathan gets up in the front with the flashlight so nobody come over and hit me. And Kevin is sitting next to the door, actually standing in the doorway, making sure I don't go in the ditch because it's so foggy. And we start our descent down, and I watch Kevin. He's over there just to pray. He's already rebuking demons. He's already rebuking devils. He's already rebuking imps. About anything and everything you can think of rebuking, Kevin was ever rebuking. And he starts to say, Lord, I believe the blood of Jesus over this bus. Angels of God, protect this bus. Keep us out of the ditch, God, and don't let anybody hit us. All I can say is it worked because we got there on the same. I thank God for young men tonight. Praise God. Did you make that a Kevin Jesus?
In hard times, we've
so thankful that the God that we serve tonight is not dead. But he's still in business. He's still in the saving business. He's still in the delivering business. He's still in the providing business. He's still in the healing business. Our God is not dead, but he's still in business. I want you to say this with me. My God's not dead.
Yeah.
trill, and trill, and trill, and trill. The Holy Ghost power is here. Come and think of our imagination. It's real, and trill, and trill. Praise God, it's trill, and trill, and trill. I know the world won't understand it. Before you're seated, look at somebody next to you and say, the Lord is in this house. Amen. Amen. My wife's grandfather, who's already gone on to be with the Lord, when I pastored, he was one of my charter members. Great, great, great man of God. Preacher of the gospel. I used to get him to testify, and he'd get happy. And though he couldn't move his legs free, he would dance the best he could in one spot. And then it's, I want to say something. He said people are scared of the Holy Ghost. They think it's a booger. He said, you don't have to be scared of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost will keep the boogers off of you. I said amen to that. Oh, it's real, it's real, it's real. The Holy Ghost, my, how many of you glad you're in church tonight? Praise God. Thank you for being here tonight. Oh, I just thank God for Brother DePere and this wonderful church. A wonderful day of homecoming yesterday, and then wanted to go right into Holy Ghost revival. Amen. I'll tell you, I love your pastor. You have 10 church years. He said we had some fellowship today, and just telling some stories of reminiscing of revivals and tent meetings and things that happened in church. And we just had a wonderful, wonderful time. And I just love your pastor and his wife and the fellowship that we have had already. And thank God for this wonderful church. Let me see if you're visiting here tonight. I know that we, that Brother Blackwood here, we've already, he's already blessed us tonight with leading us in prayer. And some of us have come tonight visiting. We have some from the South Haven Church of God, the sound man back over there, and just an honor to have him here tonight. And just wherever you're visiting from, thank you for being here. So good to see Chas and Charlotte and her husband tonight. And Jim and the others, and the bells there from the nice church there. Just honored to have them here. Wherever you're visiting, thank you for being here tonight. And I believe that when we leave for tonight, that we're going to leave together, said it's been good to be in the Father's house. Amen. How many of you have the Word with me tonight? Would you take your Bibles and hold them up high for just a minute, if you would? This is what puts the devil on the run, is the Word of God. God's word never fails. He's true to his word. He's bonded to his word. You cannot separate him from his word. He watches over his word and perform it. He can swear by none other, so he swore by his own name. That's how much his word is a bond to him. I want to talk to us tonight on the subject that I believe is very needful in this hour. Debra was talking about the song that God brought into her spirit. And many people have asked, is there a story behind this song? Many songs that she writes, God, she does write many of them through experiences or maybe through somebody that says something, or she's written many in revivals or services like this, something that is said in a service, and she just jots it down, and then the Spirit of God begins to unfold it in her spirit. She's been asked many times about miracle making. Was there a story behind it? Was you going through something? somebody in your family. Every time she says no, she said, many of my songs have been written from personal experiences. And she said, this particular song, the Spirit of God just dropped it into my spirit. And she said, I believe for this reason, for those that need a miracle. For those that need a miracle. Not to curb what she said, we have sung this song for over 20 years. I've watched them sing it time and time again. But it's like there's just a freshness, as she said. We're going to minister. It's like people are hearing it. I'm sure there is another group of people, especially the younger generation, that never heard the song, heard it much, getting introduced to it now. It's just like there's just a hunger that's reaching out. Because so many people are hurting today in our need. And I'm so thankful that God cares about where we are tonight. He cares about our families. He cares about our marriages, our children, our finances, our job, our business. If it concerns us, it concerns Him tonight. Because of what you might be facing tonight or what you might be going through, I want you to know tonight that God cares about you tonight. I simply want to talk to us for the next few minutes on a subject, as I said, that is very, very dear to me. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn with me tonight, please, to the book of St. Mark's Gospel. The book of St. Mark's Gospel tonight. Go with me, if you would, to chapter 5. St. Mark chapter 5, and beginning with verse 21. St. Mark chapter 5, beginning with verse 21. Let me also say tonight, we're so glad to have Debra and Sheri's cousin with us tonight, Jimmy and Debra, and their grandson, I believe. Is that right? Amen. We're just so honored to have them with us tonight. Brother Jimmy helped us with our equipment last night over University Parkway Church of God, and then he knew we had to come back over 7 days. He says, tell me what time we'll be there, and I want to be there. So he was here somewhere between 9:30 and 10. We told him here at 10. He'd come riding up on his motorcycle. Amen. It's just an honor to have him here with us tonight. This is a story tonight that I'm sure that you've heard many preachers preach about. I'm sure that you have read it many times. There have been many, many songs that have been taken from these passages of Scripture. Matter of fact, there's a miracle to make. Debra took a verse from this setting here. And there's two characters tonight in the story that I'm going to be talking about. The first character, the word gives a name. But the second character of the story tonight has no name. And I heard one preacher preach this years ago. He said, simply because that we can insert our name there. I don't know if that's really the biblical reason or not. It sounds pretty good. But regardless of what we go through tonight, where we're at in our walk tonight in life, there is a God tonight that we can touch out in faith and receive. And there's nothing too hard for Him to do. Look with me, if you would, in Mark's Gospel, chapter 5, beginning with verse 21. The Bible says that when Jesus was passed over again by ship into the other side, much people gathered unto Him, and He was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there come one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw the Lord, he fell at His feet and besought Him greatly. Please notice this. His need was so pressing that he sought the Lord with everything within sight of him. He sought Him greatly. And he said to the Lord, my little daughter lies at the point of death. I plead with thee, come and lay your hands on her that she may be healed and she shall live. And Jesus went with him. Now please notice verse 24. And Jesus went with him. Say that with me. And Jesus went with him. Now the story quickly is going to change here. Because the Bible says now here comes a woman which is not named. A woman that has an issue of blood, the Bible says, for many years and suffered many things, many physicians, and it's been all that she had It was nothing better, but she grew worse. When she heard of Jesus, she comes in the press. The crowd begins to force her way through the crowd and press her way through the crowd. For she said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. The Bible says that she turns, she felt in her body that virtue had went into her from the Lord, and the issue of the blood had dried up. She trembles knowing what has happened, falls before the Lord, and begins to tell the Lord a story. And Jairus is standing there now, and the Bible says, here comes one from Jairus' house that said, trouble the master any further. But the word said, in verse 36, as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he said unto her, unto him, mother, be not afraid, only believe. Be not afraid, only believe. I want to talk to us for the next few minutes on the subject tonight. What to do when your faith is tried. What to do when your faith is tried. If you would tonight, I want you just to reach over. If you would come on and do it slow, and take the person's hands next to you tonight. And let's just come in agreement prayer tonight that God would speak to us through His Word, and that faith would be lifted high in this house tonight. And as we come into this altar service tonight, that faith would be so lifted high that every need that is in this house of the touch of God tonight will be met. Lord, we praise you for it. Would you, let's pray together. Father, I thank you tonight for your touch that is in this house. Lord, I thank you for your presence and your anointing that is so rich in this house. Lord, if we dismiss service right now and we left this sanctuary, we can already leave saying it's been good to be in your house. But Lord, I believe you have even greater things for us tonight through the preaching of your word. And I'm asking you that you would flow through me as your messenger. Touch my mouth that I will think clearly, and my lips that I will speak clearly. Touch the sound of my voice to hear your word tonight, Lord. If there's one among us that is not saved, Lord, I pray that you will draw them tonight, that they'll receive you as Lord. If there's one that is discouraged, then I'm going to bring encouragement tonight. If there's one, God, that needs divine intervention and to suddenly turn around in their life, a divine suddenly, let this be the night, Lord, that they receive it. And I pray that when we leave this sanctuary tonight, that we would leave together saying it's been good to be in the Father's house. And everyone said amen and amen. Would you give the Lord a great big hand up for praise tonight? You so will be praised. You keep the kings, Lord, Lord. Amen. I want you, if you would tonight, to turn to the person next to you. I want you to say this with me. Say, I believe God can do the impossible. Would you say that? I believe God can do the impossible. I'm sure tonight that the devil has told some of you tonight in this house that it is over. It will never turn around. But I'm declaring to you tonight that it is not over. And God is still a God tonight that has the power to turn it around. I believe tonight that God is raising up a group of believers, a group of believers who will trust Him for miracles in their life. Matter of fact, I believe that God is going to do the impossible tonight in impossible times. I'm going to say that again. I believe that God is going to do the possible tonight in impossible times. For the Bible says in Mark 10:27, with men it is impossible, but not with God. For with God all things are possible. I believe that divine turnarounds are possible with God. I believe that divine suddenlies are possible with God. I believe instant miracles are possible with God. I simply believe that God can take what the devil has meant for bad instantly and turn it around and bring good out of it, because we still serve a God of possible. Can you say amen to that? But I believe tonight in miracles. Not only do I believe in miracles, but I believe in the God of miracles. There's never been just an era or time of miracles. Ever since God has been, and God has always been, there's been miracles. God's nature is miracles. You'll discover that in the book of Genesis as you read, and throughout the Old Testament, you'll see how God performed miracle after miracle after miracle. When the children of Israel came out of Egyptian bondage, God delivered them with a miracle. He brought them through the wilderness with a miracle. They passed the Red Sea with a miracle. They came to the fiery furnace with a miracle. They came to the lion's den with a miracle. Everywhere the church went, God proved himself by honoring himself with them with miracles. And I want to declare to you tonight, God can still prove himself to us because he is a God of miracles. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Now, God does not perform a miracle just for the sake of performing a miracle. But God performs a miracle to show himself mighty among his people. Matter of fact, in studying for this message, I looked at the word miracle in Webster's dictionary to see how Webster defines a miracle. And Webster defines a miracle as this. He said it is any occurrence that cannot be explained by the laws of nature. It is a marvel. Is not that the God that we serve tonight? Matter of fact, the word tells us in Genesis chapter 20, verse 17, it gives us the first story of a miracle in the Bible. It tells us that Abraham prayed unto God, and God healed Abimelech as his wife. Or we could say it was the first Eden miracle in the Bible. The Bible says in Genesis 18, verse 14, the question was asked, is there anything too hard for God to do? And then in Jeremiah chapter 32, verses 17 and 27, it says, ah, Lord God, there is nothing too hard for you to do. For the stretching out of your hand, you created the heaven and you created the earth. What the writer was saying, God, by the stretching out of your hand, if you can create the heaven and if you can create the earth, then God, you can do anything. It's not a question, can God do it? I want you to know God can do it tonight. Somebody around you and say, God can't do it tonight. It makes no difference what you're facing tonight. God can do it. It makes no difference what you're up against tonight. God can take care of it, for he's still a God of miracles. Lord, give him a hand like a praise. Amen. I was introduced to miracles when I was just a mere baby, a little child actually. I was just at the age when mom and dad said that I was able to start scooting around and not trying to pull myself up on things. My daddy started a church in Macon, Georgia, which is now known as the Real Life Church of God. And he started it and he said he was still working a public job as he was getting this church started. He had came in from working as a sheet metal mechanic at the Warner Robins Air Force Base. He had come in from that evening from work that day. Mother fixed him some coffee, set it there on the little counter. And my mama said that I turned around and pulled myself up before she knew it, and my hand caught the top of that counter, and it just scooped that hot cup of coffee over on me. And they said it just began to pour down my body. My skin, they said, began to roll off my body. My daddy jerked me up. He wrapped a towel around me, and he took me to the medical center there in Macon. They called in the pediatrician surgeons and the doctors that would work on me with the burns. They immediately began to work on me, and they told my parents that this is some of the worst second and third degree burns that I ever saw on a baby. And they informed my dad that the child talking about me would have to have many surgeries in life. And they put me right on and started skin grafting. My daddy looked at that doctor as he started to walk out of the room. He said, doctor, I don't know if you believe in a higher power. I don't know if you believe in a God. I don't know if you believe in miracles, but I am a believer. I am also a pastor of a church here in Macon. I'm going back to my church. I'm going to call my church on a prayer and a fast chain, and we're not going to break it until something supernatural takes place in my baby's body. Glory! That doctor said, do what you've got to do, sir, Reverend. We're going to do what we've got to do. My mom would not leave my side. Said from a week to the day had went by. The doctors walked in the room of the prayer. The church was still praying and fasting. The doctor walked in the room, took an instrument, unwrapped my face, unwrapped my hands and my shoulder. And up under that was fresh baby, or rather a scab, where they grabbed it. They touched it with the instrument. It fell off that skin, the crusted over skin up under was fresh baby skin. The doctor looked at my parents and said, we have never saw anything quite like this quickly. This is not supposed to happen like this. The Lord informed my dad that I would have to have an battery of surgeries as my body grew, that I would have to go back and have different kind of surgery because of that. I've never had one other surgery. I never bothered me in a day in my life. The only way that I know if I've got one scar here and and one with any scar there on my arm. I believe in miracles. I know God can do the impossible. He's the God of miracles. 13 years of age, fear came against me. Didn't know exactly what it was at first. I began to have some problems. My throat swelled up like that I was dying. They now call them panic attacks. Back then, they had not diagnosed them as panic attacks. My parents would take me to the doctor. They would check me. Not one thing wrong with my throat. But at night, my throat would start swelling, thinking that I was going to suffocate. I don't hear somebody having a growth in their body or heart problems, and like I could feel the heart problems. I got to the place I walked around checking my pulse, thinking that I was going to die. And the doctors told me, they said, son, there's not one thing medically we can find wrong with you. I put my parents through all kind of misery during that year or so, taking me to doctor after doctor, emergency room after emergency room, trying to heal my problem. No one could help me. Finally, one doctor said, we're going to put you on nerve tablets, young man. This is what's going to help you. He said, we don't know what else to do. You ought to be out playing football. How I wanted to be, but it had such a hold on me. Fear is a real spirit friend. Dream. I remember one night, a friend of mine called me. He said, Quint, there's a revival going on in Warner Robins, Georgia. God is using this evangelist. God's flowing through him with the gifts. Miracles are happening. And if we can get you to this revival, I believe you're going to get deliverance from that spirit of fear that's got a hold of you. And I told my mom and dad, revival was going on. Can I go? And they was all up for it. They prayed over me. They done everything they knew to do. But for whatever reason, I just could not get a breakthrough. So that night I go and I have my pills in my pocket in case I hit one of those attacks. I take one and calm it down. I remember sitting there at that revival that night. The preacher was preaching. Then he stopped as he went into his prayer line. And he pointed his finger. He said, there's a young man here tonight. He said, the devil trying to take you out with fear. And he began to read my mail. I had not told him one thing. I didn't know the pastor there. I certainly didn't know the evangelist there. But God knew both of them. And God had already talked to the preacher before I got there. I am telling you, friend, God still has people he talks to. Oh, yes, he does. God had talked to him. He looked at me, or he looked at that congregation, and he said, if you'll come forward tonight, God's going to deliver you. Brother, up here, there could have been 20 other young people, or young person. There could have been others here that had the same problem, but I knew I was one of them. I jumped out of my pew that night. I walked out of that aisle. I got right in front of the preacher. I said, preacher, it's me, preacher. I began to tell him what I was going through. I said, it's like you already knew it. He laid hands upon me. He began to rebuke that spirit of fear, and when he did, I began to feel a warm, healing sensation start from my head, roll over my shoulders, down my body, and over my toes. And a moment's time, I knew God had delivered me. I knew it. I walked out to the restroom. I took those bottled nerve tablets. I pulled up the commode lid, and I opened the top, and I poured them in the toilet, and I flushed it. I said, I'll never take another one in the name of Jesus. I've been delivered and set free from this. Man, I felt so good. I knew in my spiritual knowing that the Lord had healed and made me whole. I walked out of there, got in that car on my way home with my friends. From Warner Robins to where we lived in Macon was about, I don't know, 18, 20 miles or so. About halfway, all of a sudden that old same spirit trying to grip over me again. I began to feel my throat trying to swell up. My body began to tingle. My car's fixing to go out. And the devil said, this time I've got you right where I want you. This is what I've been waiting on, Quint. He said, I've got you now. You have no more tablets to take. You're too far from home to get one. He said, I'm fixing to take you out right now, right now. All of a sudden, the Spirit of God rose up inside me and said, I've not given you a spirit of fear, but a power of love. And I shall not resist the devil, and he will flee from you. I said in that car, I said, devil, you listen to me and listen to me well. You must have forgot what just happened about 15 or 30 minutes ago. Jesus set me free. Jesus delivered me. Jesus healed me. Jesus made me whole. Devil, I refuse to allow you to rob me of that miracle. I refuse to allow the spirit of fear to come back on me. In the name of Jesus, I resist you. From that moment to this, God has delivered me. I walk in total deliverance. And I thank God. I'm 50 years of age now. That was when I was a mere teenager. Give God a hand up for praise. Miracles all over. And they do last. And they do last. I said, all I can say is, I believe in miracles. God is the God of miracles. He is the Savior, healer, deliverer, provider. He can do the impossible. The nature of God is miracles. In our scripture text tonight, it gives us the story of a man. The Bible calls him Jairus. His daughter was at the point of death. He beseeches the Lord. He comes to the Lord and he brings his need before God. Now, I don't know tonight if you ever come before God with everything within you. See, when your need is so pressing tonight, it doesn't matter what anybody calls you. When your need is so pressing in your life, it doesn't matter what it looks like, what you have to do. If you knew tonight, if you crawled on your belly, if you was hit up with cancer, and if you crawled on your belly to this foot and crawled to the back door, then you would automatically be delivered and healed. You wouldn't care what anybody thought. You would do it. Would you not?
Yeah.
It wouldn't matter if your boss man was sitting next to you. It wouldn't matter if another pastor, you wouldn't care less, because you would die. If you knew without a miracle, you were going to die. But if you could crawl on your belly and back, you would be healed. You'd do it. You see, when you get desperate enough for God, and you get desperate enough to be touched of God, it won't matter what anybody calls you, what they think about you. Maybe some of you are there tonight. Maybe some of you are at a place in life and you say, preacher, I've got to have a miracle in my family. I've got to have a miracle in my children. I've got to have a miracle in my marriage. I've got to have a miracle in my finances. I've got to have a miracle in my job and my business. I've got to have a miracle, preacher, in my own physical body. I've got to get to Jesus. The Bible says that he beseeches the Lord greatly. He didn't care what anybody thought about him. He comes to the Lord. And he says, Lord, my daughter's at the point of death. I need you to come and heal my daughter, Lord. She's about to die, but if you'll come and lay your hand upon her, she'll not die, but she'll live. Jesus looked at him. He said, let's go. So they start out going to Jairus' house. Can you imagine how Jairus is feeling? All of a sudden, inside him, he's changing. My daughter will live. She'll not die. He's a miracle worker. My daughter's not going to die. I'm going to live. Cannot wait to get to his house. Just walking with the Lord to his house, there was a miracle in the making. And he knew it. All of a sudden, the crowd gets heavy around the Lord. All of a sudden, he hears somebody say, Jesus, touch me, Jesus. Jesus, help me, Jesus. Jesus, I need you, Lord. And Jesus is taking time to touch one after the other. And the Bible says that here comes a woman which has no name, but the Lord doesn't give her name. And the Bible tells us that she begins to press her way through. Now, if you remember what we read tonight in the Word, the Bible says that here was a woman that her husband had passed away, left her an inheritance, and she was living on that. But during this time, a sickness hit her body. And many Bible theologians believe that it was a blood issue, a female condition. She's literally bleeding to death as the days and weeks and months went by. So she began to seek out medical advice. She went to one doctor after another doctor. She went to one specialist after another specialist. No doctors at that time could help her. No specialists at that time could help her. They did not know what to do with her condition. Literally, she was dying, so they sent her home to die. And I can just picture, at her closing hours, there was a lady there that was a caretaker that was aiding her, helping her needs until she passed away. Lying there on that bed, so weak she lost so much blood. All of a sudden, there's a knock on the door. The nurse goes to the door. There stands a couple of people there. They had just been witnessing what the Lord had been doing. How he had unlocked deaf ears. How he caused a lame to walk. How he performed miracle after miracle. They had witnessed this. And they knew that their friend was at the point of death. And it hit them. If we can get her to where Jesus is at, Jesus will touch her. And a miracle will take place in her life. Oh. So they knock on the door. door is open and there stands the nurse. And they're so beside themselves. They said, look, we were just down here at Peter's house. And Jesus was down here. The man named Jesus, have you heard about him? He's raised the dead. He's turned the water into wine. He's fed the thousand with a few loaves and fish. He's performed miracle after miracle after miracle. If we could just get her down to where Jesus was at, Jesus will touch her and give her a miracle. Please let us in together. And the nurse said, you don't understand. No doctor can help her. No specialist can help her. You don't understand, her case is incurable. They've sent her home to die. Please leave. I'll tell them you come by, but please leave. And they shut the door. All of a sudden, there was a knock again on the door. This time, one of them stuck the foot inside the door. In case they shut it, they could still get in. They said, but you don't understand. We've not come to tell you just about a doctor. We've come to tell you about the doctor. He's not just a physician. He's the master physician. He's not just a specialist. He's the specialist. He's never lost a case. You've got to let us get inside and take her to Jesus.
Amen.
I can hear the woman saying, who is it? Who is it? Who is it? Did I hear somebody say that there's a man named Jesus that's never lost a case, that he's a healer? Please come in and tell me about it. Please come in. They walk on in, and the nurse said, you don't understand. Please don't give her any false hope. Nothing can be done for her. She's going to die. Please, please leave. Please leave. She's going to die. But the woman says, tell me about this man named Jesus. And they walked over to her and they looked at him and they said, listen, we just let the man named Jesus right down the street. He's unlocking deaf ears. He's causing the lame to walk. They said that he fed 1,000 with a few loaves and fish. They said he calmed the storm for his disciples on a boat the other day. Why, he's a miracle worker. We have witnessed this. And if we can get you there, I know he'll heal you.
Amen.
I can imagine this woman looking up and saying, please, please, get me there. I don't want to die, I want to live. Get me there. And I can see the nurse saying, no, 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 you don't understand what you're doing here. No, she's going to die. She's lost too much blood. She can never make it. But I can believe the woman just whispered and said, if I lay here, I'm going to die anyhow. At least let me get up. At least let me try. Listen to me. Many times the devil screams at us, what's the use? It's not going to turn around. What's the use? There'll never be a breakthrough. What's the use? That healing will never come. Just go ahead and lay there. You might as well give up. But I'm declaring to you tonight as a man of God, don't you sit there until you die. Make up your mind. I'm going after it. I still believe there's a God of miracles. I'll not sit here. I'll not listen to the lies of hell no more. I'm going to get up and go after my miracle. Amen?
Amen.
They get her up. The nurse is trying to stop them, but they're going ahead. The nurse is behind, and they're towing the lady on the stretcher. Some are saying, Jesus, touch me, Jesus. Jesus, heal me, Jesus. One says, I can see. I can see. The Lord says, I can hear. I can move this leg now that was still, it's moving. I'm healed. There are many screaming and hollering, giving God praise because what happened? The woman's hearing this. Where is he at? Where is he at? He's up there in the crowd. He's up in the crowd. Please just stand me up. Stand me up. And the nurses said, no, no, honey. You've lost too much blood. You'll never make it. You're too weak. You'll never get to him. Oh, please, I want to walk. Please just hold me up. Get beside me. Just help me. I want to do it. Just let me go. And then she begins to push her way through, the Bible says. And she starts declaring, if I can just touch him, you just let me get to where he's at. If I can just touch him, let me just touch the hem of his garment, I know I shall be made whole.
Yeah.
And she begins to press. Listen to me, that's the whole message right there, pressing. You might feel that you're in a press mode right now. You might feel that you're having to press your way through discouragement. Having to press your way through unbelief. Maybe some of you had to press your way to get to church tonight. Some of you might just have to press your way to get up in the morning to go to work. You just press your way through life. And the devil's trying to bring discouragement to you. Just give you every reason in the book why to give up on what you're believing God for. But I'm declaring to you tonight as a man of God, don't you give up. You press.
press, you press, you press, you press, you press, you keep pressing. Just as soon as you press, you will touch the hem of his garment. Amen.
Look at somebody and say, don't give up. You're too close to give up. Press his way through. Jesus is moving. Go to Lord Jairus' house. This woman is pressing. And she sees Jesus. And she reaches out and she touched the tassel that was on his garment, symbolic of the word. She grabs a hold of it. And when she did, all of a sudden, she felt something go in her body. You talk about being bit by electricity, friend. Oh, come on now. You talk about having a touch like you've never had a touch. She had that touch. All of a sudden, you talk about a blood transfusion. It was an instantaneous blood transfusion within her body. All of a sudden, she felt fresh strength go inside her. She felt it so much, she just stopped. And she said something, I feel something happening to me. Jesus felt it. He stopped. He turned around and said, somebody touched me. John, was it you? Mark, was it you? Luke, was it you? Somebody touched me. And they said, Lord, look at this crowd around you. Anybody could have touched you. Anybody could have touched you. And the Bible says the woman, fearing, trembling, knowing what had just happened to her body, she comes before the Lord and she comes before him and she begins to testify to the Lord what had happened. The whole story before the Lord. Jesus looks at her and he said, daughter, go your way. But he also says something very interesting. He says, go in peace. Look at someone say, peace. Go in peace. And behold, no plan. Now, I often wonder, why did Jesus look at her and say, go in peace, daughter? And behold, no plan. Why did he just say, go? You've been healed now. Go. Thy faith hath made you whole. But he said, go in peace. When I read that, I'm thinking, why did he say that? And here's what I believe why Jesus said to her, go in peace. It's because he knew that the devil was trying to bring those same symptoms back to her. Maybe a week later. Maybe a month later. Maybe 6 months down the road. Maybe a year later. Those same symptoms of bleeding would return to her. And the devil tried to rob her of that healing, saying that she didn't get it. But Jesus said, you stand in the peace and I have touched you and I have made you whole. I'm declaring you tonight, you can stand in the peace of God in the midst of the storms of life, in the midst of what hell is blowing you away. You can stand in the peace of God knowing that God did it. It's done. Can you say amen? Amen. I can just picture now, Jairus is very antsy. He's standing there. He's very fidgety now. He's waiting patiently. Every moment is crucial now because his daughter's at the point of death. And he's thinking to himself, all right, woman, you've got your miracle. I'm so thankful you're not going to die now, but you're going to live. If you'll just kindly get out of the way and let Jesus proceed on to my house, we'll get a miracle out of the house. While he's waiting there, waiting on Jesus to start back to his house to heal his daughter, one of his servants comes to him, whispers in his ear, Jairus, Jairus. Yes, what is it? There's no use. Trouble the master any further. Your daughter just died. Can you imagine how he's thinking? He's standing there. He's looking. All kind of feelings is going through him. Emotions he's having. He's struggling with right now. I don't understand it. I was this close to a miracle for my daughter. Jesus is on the way to my house. If this woman had not come on the scene, Jesus would already have been to my house and my daughter would not have died. She would have been made whole. But because of you, my daughter's dead. Now, I don't know about you, but no doubt I'd be having those thoughts. I'd be dealing with those feelings. The Bible says Jesus turned. Read it, it's there, and he looked at Jairus. As soon as he heard the word that was spoken to Jairus, the Bible says, he said, be not afraid, only believe. Look at somebody and say that. Be not afraid, only believe. He puts his arm around Jairus and he starts walking. Jairus is thinking about this thing. What am I going to do? Who am I going to believe? Am I going to believe my servant, who's been faithful to me and loyal to me for years, who's never lied to me? Or am I going to believe Jesus, who I just met? Am I going to believe Jesus? Or am I going to believe my servant? I know my servant wouldn't lie to me. My daughters must have died. Then on the other side, I cannot deny Jesus, because I watched him open blinded eyes. I watched him unlock deaf ears. I watched him just heal the woman that had the issue of blood. I watched him perform miracle after miracle just in a short time. So who am I going to believe? He's weighing this in the balance. You see, there comes a time in our life, who are we going to believe? Are we going to believe this economy, this so-called recession? Are we going to believe the report from the doctor? Are we going to believe the report of how it looks in the natural? Or are we going to believe the God of the supernatural? The God that can do the impossible? The God that spoke this world into existence? The God that knows how many hairs upon our head? The God that scooped out the ocean and piled up the mountains? The God that said, let there be, and there was? The God that knows what our needs are in this house? Who are we going to believe? He's called their hand. He's got to make a choice. Jesus said, Jairus, be not afraid, only believe. It's back in your court now. It's up to you. He says, I'm going to believe. I have nothing to lose. I'm going to believe. I can't deny what I saw. He starts walking. No doubt Jesus puts his arms around Jairus, looks into his eyes as to say, Jairus, did I not give you a promise that I said I was going to go to your house and heal your daughter? Now one thing has changed. Just because this woman pressed her way through and touched me and I took time to heal her, it's not changed one word that I've given to you. If I said I'm going to go, I'm going to go. Let me just stop and say this right here. I don't know what you might be going through. I don't know what you might be facing. But how many of God's given you a word before? It might have been in your prayer closet. It might have been here in Pastor Nadir. It might have been in your own church, but God's given you a rhema word. It might have been on a fast. God's given you a word. Just because it's not manifested there, don't you think it's not going to happen, friend? When God gives you a word, when God gives you a rhema word, you can stand upon it. You can take it to the bank. You can hang your head upon it. God is faithful to his word. God watches over his word to perform it. Don't let go of what God's promised you. Well, look at somebody and say, don't let go of what God's promised you. His faith is being tried now. Can you imagine all the way to his house? The enemy's talking to him. You're a fool, Jairus. You're a fool. You know what your servant just said to you? Your daughter's dead. Why are you going to your house, Jairus? It's too late, Jairus. Why do you have the master going on with you? It's too late, Jairus. You might as well give up. I want to tell you tonight, I don't care how it looks, the devil might be breathing hot air down your back. You might have got some words of discouragement today, but don't you give up on your miracle. Don't you give up on what you believe in God for. You dig it like a bulldog saying, devil, I want you to know. I don't know about what I see. I don't know about how I feel. I know according to the word of Almighty God. God said it, devil. I want you to know that settles it. I believe it. Oh, somebody say praise. They get right to Jairus' house. The mourners had already come to city. The doubt. You know, it's amazing. When you believe in God for a breakthrough, you believe in God for a turnaround, you believe in God for a divine suddenly, a divine interruption. You believe in God to turn something around that the devil is meant for bad. You believe in God to step inside the middle of it and start clearing the way for you. It's amazing how some will come up and tell you why you might as well give up. Why it's not going to happen. And they'll tell you why it's not going to happen. You might as well go ahead and give up on this thing. It's not going to take place. Maybe some of you are there right now. Oh, maybe some of you are there. I've watched this young man on Facebook. I've seen the progress he's been making, what he's been believing God for. I want to remember, there's probably some said you might as well give up. I'm telling you, friend, don't you ever give up. Don't you ever give up. With man, it is impossible. But not with God. For with God, all things are possible. With God, all things are possible. With God, all things are possible. Don't give up. I'm going to stand here for you if you want. Look at somebody and say, don't give up, don't give up, don't give up. They get to his house. The mourners have sat in, crying, mourning the dead. It was the custom of Bible days for them to mourn the dead. They were there to mourn. Jesus gets there with Jairus. His servant standing beside him. Jesus takes control of the situation. He walks inside and he gets the mourners out. He starts getting the unbelievers out of the house. Now let me just stop and say right here. When you're believing for divine suddenly, and you're believing for a turnaround, and you're believing for a miracle, when your faith is being tried to the limit, there's some people you've got to stop talking to. There's some people you've got to stop listening to. Because everybody will not believe with you. Everybody will not stand with you. Everybody will not talk faith with you. You've got to stand with somebody that's going to say, I don't care how it looks right now, I'm going to believe God with you. I'm going to believe God with you. I don't care what's thrown in your face, I'm going to believe God. I'm not judge shit with you. I'm going to trust God with you. I'm going to believe God. Many people are there when everything's going good. But when hell starts blowing you away, some jump ship. Some runs away. I don't know about you, but God's looking for somebody that'll say, hey, I'm going to stand. I don't care what the economy is saying, what the recession is saying, what skeptics are saying, what man is saying. I'm going to stand and take God at his word. We're in covenant with a covenant keeping God. He gets there. He gets all the mourners out. And then he walks over to the little girl. And he starts speaking a miracle into existence. He starts speaking life. Look at somebody and say, you can speak the word of God. You can declare the word of God. And this is where we said to say Christians believe, well, God is in control of everything, so it just makes no difference what's going to happen. God's control of everything, so life just happens. I beg to differ with that, friend. I have scripture on that. I don't believe God is in control of a man that rapes a woman. I don't believe God is in control of someone who walks out here and murders somebody. I don't believe God is in control of somebody taking their life. I don't believe God is in control of cancer and disease in a body. I don't believe God predestines our set. I believe our decisions, or I should say the results of our decisions we make in life are predestined. Because the word declares that. What do you mean, preacher? The Bible says, if you're willing and obedient, if you trust me, if you honor me, if you obey my word, then these things will happen in your life. But if you choose not to honor my word, then also this will happen. Those consequences are predestined. So what he's simply saying, this. I made up my mind. I'm going to speak the word of God and declare the word of God and watch things change. Because the Bible says we can do that. The Bible says we can speak life. The Bible says we can declare His word. If you have an unsaved family member, a husband, wife, or son, or daughter, you know what you ought to do? You ought to walk in their bedroom. You ought to walk to their truck, their car. You ought to start laying your hand over their bed sheets. Lay your hand over their steering wheel. Lay your hand over their truck, their car, and say, John, Luke, Donna, Cindy, you're saved. I don't care what you might be doing now. I don't care how bound you might be right now. Those alcohol chains have got to come off. That drug addiction has got to leave. Come on now. In the name of Jesus, I speak salvation over you. My brother-in-law, my close-in-law, my brother-in-law has a very good friend up in Union, Georgia. His child had had an injury and become very sick. And was just like in a coma, lifeless. The doctors wanted to give him up, just let him go ahead and die. But his mom and dad, they were believers. He said, we're not giving up. If we take him home, we're not giving up. Until he draws his last breath. We're not giving up. We're going to speak life over our boy. We're going to speak life over his boy. The man was very wealthy. He made a lot of money. Put it back. He had taken his money and cared for his boy. Thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars he cared for him. Had to feed him every day. Had to change him every day. Lay him there limp. Couldn't do anything. His mind wasn't right. But every day that mother walked in there and she looked over her boy. And she spoke life to her boy. She spoke healing over her boy. She spoke the word of God over her boy. When people said, you might as well give up. When they said, it's not going to happen. You might as well go ahead, put him in the home zone. He's not going to get no better. She kept speaking life over him. She kept speaking healing over him. I want you to know, just because nothing's happened right now, there's no sign that something's not moving. Something not stirring. Don't you give up on the God of this world. Months, year, quite a long time that went by. She got weary. Her flesh wanted to give up, but she kept doing it. Honey, one day you're gonna open your eyes. One day you're gonna run again. One day you'll play sports again. One day you'll be normal again. I'm not giving up till I draw my last breath. I'm gonna speak a miracle over your body. He walked in one day, all of a sudden the eyes opened up. The hand started moving. His legs started moving. A few weeks later, he was out of the bed. A few months later, he was doing some sports again. The doctors could not believe what they were witnessing. I am telling you, friend, don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up tonight. We still serve a God of the breakthrough. We still serve a God that can do the impossible. He is still a God of miracles. Look at somebody and say, don't give up tonight. Don't give up. Jesus looks. He speaks life to this child. All of a sudden, her heart begins to beat. Her muscles begin to spasm. Her eyes begin to flutter. She wakes up. And she says, Mom, I'm hungry. Jesus said, give her something to eat. Oh, give him a hand up of praise. Hallelujah. Telling you tonight. I don't know where you might be at tonight. You say, preacher, my faith has been tried. Don't give up tonight. Don't give up tonight. You're too close tonight. God is faithful to His word. Father, I thank you tonight for your word. I thank you, God, for your anointing that's in this house. I thank you for your presence, God, that we feel so richly in this house tonight. Lord, you see every man tonight, every woman, every young person. God, you know every care, every need, God, every concern tonight that's in this house. And Lord, we come in agreement tonight. We believe in you tonight, Lord. Every need that is in this house, every concern that is in this house, we believe you got for breakthroughs tonight. We believe you for divine settings tonight, for turnarounds tonight, Lord. We believe in you, God, to honor your word in this house tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I want you right now, if you would, just lift up your hands and begin to praise him. Before we go any further, would you just lift up your hands and begin to praise him right now? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just begin to praise him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I don't know where you're at tonight in your walk. There could be somebody here tonight that you're not saved. To me, that's the greatest miracle of all, is a miracle of salvation. You might say, preacher, my life has been twisted. My life is wrecked tonight. I don't know the Lord is my Savior, and I don't want to leave out of here the same way that I walked in. I need his mercy tonight, preacher. I need God's mercy. You might say, preacher, there are some things in my life. I'm a Christian. Yeah, there's some things in my life that I need a breakthrough. I need a turnaround, preacher. I need a miracle, preacher. I need God to come out in the middle of my situation. There could be somebody here tonight with panic attacks like I had. There could be somebody here tonight with nerves, problems. There could be somebody here tonight when you're going through a trying time in your marriage. Maybe with your children, your grandchildren. Maybe on your job, your business, financially you're being retired. Preacher, physically, I've got to have some healings in my body. Or maybe something I'm not even touched on. You're going through tonight and you've got to have God to get in the middle of your situation. You've got to know that God knows where you're at tonight. And that if something's fixing to shift and turn, you've got to have a divine breakthrough tonight. Wherever you're at tonight, friend, God's going to meet you tonight. The church of God's in this house. Brother, appear when you can. I want you to come up here with me. And all the other visiting ministers, if you're a pastor, evangelist, or just a lay preacher, a minister of the gospel, I want you to come up here and stand with me and Brother appear tonight. If you would, just come up here and stand with us tonight. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Now, here's what I want us to do. I want you to be very, very closely tonight. I still believe tonight that God honors his word. I still believe tonight, if any of you would come in agreement, touching the Lord, it'll be done tonight. I still believe that the God that we serve tonight can rebuke the storms that are raised in our life and speak peace in our life. How many of you believe that tonight? And here's what I want us to do tonight. If you have any kind of care tonight, any kind of need tonight, I want you to step out. And I want us to have a prayer line tonight. And I want you to walk by we ministers. And as you walk by we ministers, we're going to lay our hands upon you. And we're going to let God going to touch you and meet you as you come to this prayer line tonight. Regardless of how you feel tonight, what the enemy's told you tonight, we're believing tonight that God is going to honor his word tonight in your life. How many of you believe that tonight? How many of you believe that? I want everyone that would tonight, I want you just to step out right now. And I want you just to form a line right here. Just form a line. Just form a line right here. Great. Can we have maybe some of the ministers get on this side here? Amen. Just let them walk through us. That's right. Just come on. Just come on. Everyone that would, on everyone that would tonight. If you have a need or not, I want everyone that would to walk through this prayer line. For no other reason tonight. I want you to walk through this prayer line just to get a fresh touch of God tonight in your life.